Hi, this is Kevin Deal from Upscale Audio, and today we're going to talk about people that are very, very famous designers in the loudspeaker business. This is Andrew Jones from ELAC. He is the Vice President of Engineering, and Andrew Jones is an icon in the speaker space. We were having such a fun time, right, Andrew? We were talking about drugs just a few minutes ago, talking about the early days of hi-fi in
and
California.
No touching. No touching, by the way.
No touching. We only touched elbows here. We talked about drugs, and I found out that while I was dropping acid and doing all of that stuff during my early days in the hi-fi business, he did not.
Because I was being a good boy.
He was in the UK, and I guess it was kind of a California thing.
Certainly also.
But before the day's out, I'm going to have a way to have him do a little microdosing LSD.
One pill makes you larger, and one pill makes you small.
So, what we're going to talk about today, this is the debut signature bookshelf speaker. It is the latest model, and it is so hot, it is unbelievable. What we're going to do is we're going to talk about what makes the speaker so good. Well, but before we even go there, why don't you tell me, now, your history and who you work for now, let's get a backup on this.
Okay. One of the things I like to say is when people talk about how long they've been interested in hi-fi, and you know, they give some kind of time period, and I say, I've always been into hi-fi because, true fact, I have an identical twin brother. He's left-handed, I'm right-handed. So we were born as a stereo pair, so it seemed a natural thing to do. Got interested in early teens, in hi-fi and electronics, and we decided by the time it came to go to university that I'd already started specializing my interest in speakers. To this day, I don't know why, but I did, and my brother stayed with electronics. So he went off to one university to do electronics. I did physics and acoustics at my university, and then I joined him at his university in postgraduate research. For my part, researching computer-aided crossover network design, and he was doing researching amplifier topologies. After that, I spent about 3 years doing active noise control, you know, anti-noise. Mm-hmm. In those days, working on noise from diesel generator exhausts or ship's engines. My brother then joined me in that research group and continued and spent, I don't know, 30 years or so doing noise-canceling headsets. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the technologies you see in noise-canceling headsets these days are due to work he's done. But after some time in that research group, I got offered a chance to join KEF. Mm-hmm. You know, I wanted to be in the true hi-fi industry rather than just speakers mm-hmm. for anything. And I knew Laurie Fincham, who was the technical director there, from various shows, and mm-hmm. I nearly got a placement when I was at university with them for a year.
Mm-hmm. And that was back in, what, the 1990s, I guess?
Mid-70s.
Oh, mid-70s, I'm sorry. I'm thinking about, because I think when you joined CAF was right around the time of the 104.2 was in development, right?
Yes.
And let's see, what year was that? Because I remember that.
Well,
speaker.
I joined in 83, I joined CAF.
Okay.
Right. So early 80s,
yeah.
I joined them.
Yeah.
And Laurie had already published a paper on the technology, and I was at that lecture. Mm-hmm. And I had just started the research on noise control.
Got it.
And I found that the speaker they were using, unbeknownst to them, was basically a couple cavity configuration.
Right.
And they'd no clue that it was or how to tune it, and it wasn't working well.
Right.
So the first week that I'm there, I see Laurie's presentation, I get a copy of it, and as I'm looking at it, I'm going, that's what they built in the lab.
Right.
So that week, I went back, redesigned it, rebuilt it, and it started to work beautifully.
And then you went from CAF to?
So from CAF, I was there 11 years, uh-huh. worked my way up to chief engineer.
Right.
And then I was invited to come over to the States by Floyd Toole.
Right.
In fact, he brought Laurie Fincham and myself over.
And this was about what year? Because it was a special day, wasn't it?
Yes.
The day of the...
So I go in to hand in my resignation at KEF in the morning of January the 17th, 1994. 2 hours later, I get news, Northridge earthquake. I just handed in my resignation to move to Northridge, California. And everyone came running down going, did you hear the news? You don't have to go. We can tear up your resignation. Yeah. And I still came out here. And so worked for Infinity for just over 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then I was offered a chance to head up speaker design for Pioneer.
Right.
which was sort of an odd choice in a lot of people's minds because the image in those days, well, Japanese don't design good speakers.
Right.
And what they didn't realize, A, it's not really true, and B, they have world-class engineering.
Right.
I knew all the research because I'm always reading the journals. And Pioneer was amongst one of those that did all this fundamental research. So my idea was, okay, I'll go and work with a Japanese company, get access to that research, tie it in with my own, work with their engineers, we can come up with some really good stuff. And that's how it worked out. I had 17 years at Pioneer.
Wow.
A wonderful time, wonderful people.
And that is a real company. I mean, back in the day, Pioneer, I mean, we're and you know what I'm talking about with this. I always talk about this on our channel. I always talk about it. I believe in parts and engineering, parts and engineering. Some of these guys that want to buy loudspeakers, they buy speakers from companies that I call alligator clip engineers. That means they're working on a crossover and they alligator clip in another inductor or another capacitor, and that's how they come up with their designs. And that's just not the way to do things. Real engineering is what you're looking for in a loudspeaker, and that's why Andrew Jones went from Pioneer to, and then from there, the big deal, right?
Yeah, but to that engineering point, that's how TAD Home Audio came about, because TAD were known for their beryllium compression drivers in all the studios. All the top studios were using the TAD drivers.
Right.
I started a home division using beryllium technology, but in a concentric driver, because, of course, I'd got good experience with concentric drivers from when they were developed at KEF, the UniQ.
Sure.
And, of course, we look behind us. Those are concentric drivers
concentric
done in
right
different
there.
Ways,
yep.
But it's an excellent example of the basic underlying technology. And so I thought, a beryllium concentric, it'd be the only one that ever exists. And very expensive for us to produce because it's the biggest cone or driver that ever made out of beryllium. But we designed it, we built them, turned out to be a wonderful speaker.
And how much was that little bookshelf speaker?
Well, the bookshelf was $42,000.
$42,000.
And the floor stander started life at around $70,000 to $80,000. The latest version, I believe, is over $100,000.
So the story here is ELAC wanted to, I mean, you guys know that I am a champion of trying to get you something that is the top 5% of performance without spending the top 5% of money. I love that. If I see a really expensive stem out speaker, I can applaud it and I can love it for its beauty and its engineering, but I really get impressed when I see something like this. This speaker, we just listened to it and I was shocked by the bottom end performance, the reach of the lower mid band, that really surprised me because he did something when we demoed it. What was that cut we were listening to?
That was John Campbell down
John
in the hole.
I'm telling you something. It would be a cut that I would use because it's difficult for a stem mount speaker to get the chestiness of a baritone voice. And you hear me talk about this all the time because I'm always talking about Johnny Cash, but not just that. Neil Young, Lyle Lovett, Jim Morrison, my God, right? And this speaker does an amazing job. And so I asked him to bring me some parts. So why don't you tell us a little bit about this driver and a little bit about this cabinet?
Okay, in one way you could say this is the third in the series of the debut speakers that launched ELAC 5 years ago last month, right? And that was to produce very good sounding, but surprisingly affordable speakers. It originally started out at $229 a pair for the 5-inch bookshelf. Yet I was demonstrating with $4,000 of electronics to show a kind of a new way of putting a system together. So we went from original debut to debut 2.0.
Mm-hmm.
And always the fear when you've got a very popular model and you do a Mark II version,
mm-hmm.
you're going to mess it up. Are the reasons why they liked the failings, let's say, of the first version,
mm-hmm.
and if you make it better, is that better in everyone's mind,
mm-hmm.
or is it just different?
Yeah.
Well, thankfully, managed to pull that off and make a better version. But it was important to have, it's one of these hair, almost hair shirt type of designs, where the looks are okay, well, you know, tasteful, mm-hmm. but there's not really any money spent on the looks or the construction in that sense,
mm-hmm.
because we want to get maximum sound.
Mm-hmm.
And when you've got very little money, to spend. The important thing for me and priority, drivers, and I know my own drivers specific so that they give me what I need for that particular model. Then crossovers, I need to integrate the sound properly together.
Can I stop you and say something then? Because I got to talk about this. I have to take things apart. And you know, I'm going to show you a close-up of this driver. There are some manufacturers that are taking plastic cone drivers and they are stamping as if it is a woven aramid driver, which this is, which is kind of like Kevlar, but Kevlar is
made by DuPont.
DuPont, and so it's a name that's trademarked, but this is more or less the same material. But this is a true woven material, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. I mean, look at this driver. It is badass. I mean, look at a die-cast basket. I mean...
And like you Americans like to say, oversized magnet.
Right? Yes. Yeah.
But yes, a magnet as needed to give the performance that we want. But that's a very substantial driver.
Beautiful.
And so the opportunity for this was, let's go up in price point and let's put quite a lot more into it, but both in looks and performance.
Right.
So it was always drivers, then crossovers, then cabinet. So, you know, many times by my own admission, the failings, if you can point to any, was that a fairly lively cabinet in the debut original. Then I did a better job of bracing in the debut 2.0, but here I've been able to do more. And so when we look at the construction, the first obvious difference is that we've got the slot vent. And that slot is built from three layers of MDF. It's the bottom of the cabinet here. Then what forms this slot, and in cross-section, it's got a cutout in it that's shaped like that. And then another layer on top of that, which has just got a cutout for where the port expanded. So it's a hole driving into a flared slot to come out. But those three layers add mass and considerably improve the stiffness of these corners of the cabinet.
Yeah,
so it helps to control vibration.
Right.
The slot, the way we've done it, helps to control slot or vent noise. And then we've got an additional perimeter brace vertical all the way around the cabinet to help control the resonances. So much lower cabinet noise from this. And this extra baffle on the front, there's a baffle behind it, which is part of the cabinet construction, then this painted baffle added on top. So it's a double layer thickness on the front. So it's a substantial improvement in the cabinet, as well as giving it improved looks, because we've got the rounded corners, we've got the painted baffle. And so that allowed me to do better, but not just in the cabinet. The driver...
Can I say something? I want to point out something about what he's saying here is the cabinet is not lively. If you listen to cheap, inexpensive bookshelf speakers, you're going to notice that a lot of times the mid-band can have a grainy texture, and you might attribute that to maybe using cheap drivers, but it is not that oftentimes.
It's surprising what a cabinet does. At KEF, we were big on trying to decouple the drivers, to isolate them from the cabinet. The excitation of the cabinet is not due to the back wave of sound from the cone.
Right.
It's the recoil forces. The cone moves one way, the magnet pushes back the other, just like recoil in a rifle.
Right.
And that's what excites the cabinet. It's 20 times stronger, typically, than the acoustic back wave.
Wow.
So if you can control that, or that's good, but you can't always easily do it in a two-way system. So you're left with trying to control the cabinet vibration by just stiffening it up. But you certainly, at KEF, we used to do impulse testing. And that was a true impulse rather than the derived impulse that we use these days. So it was literally, you put a signal in, it goes tick, 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 encompasses all frequencies at the same time, then you do this Fourier analysis. Well, we also had an anechoic chamber. I could walk into the anechoic chamber with the speaker facing away from me, but hooked up, walk down the catwalk, and as I walked into the chamber, it went from tick, 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 which I'd hear from the front of the speaker, to doing, doing, doing. I could just hear the cabinet as I walked into there.
Right.
And so I'm particularly aware of the kind of sounds that cabinets have.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you're listening to a speaker, if you go up and just put your ear on the side, and particularly with female vocal, at some points, depending on the cabinet construction, you will go, ouch, it's so strong into your ear as you do that.
Yeah.
So cabinets are important, but in affordable speakers, I had to fix the other parts first.
Sure, sure.
Now this gives me the opportunity to fix the cabinet.
Well, I was really, really surprised by the purity of the mid-band and just the lack of coloration and distortion. So super, super impressive. And then the high-frequency driver has
A waveguide
on the front.
You can see, depending on the light, through the grill. This is a new grill, which is much more open than the Debut 2.
Okay.
Soft old tweeter, 1-inch dome.
Uh-huh.
A wide surround, which paradoxically improves the high-frequency response. It lets it go down low in frequency as well to give me greater freedom of where I choose to cross over to the woofer.
Mm-hmm.
But it goes out higher as well, close to 35K. Now, it's not... I don't get into the argument of, we can't hear 35K, why would you do that?
Mm-hmm.
It's because in the old days, soft dome tweeters, they often were at least 3 dB down by 20K.
Sure.
Sometimes more. And so what I want to do is make sure it's flat to at least 20K. Mm-hmm. So if I can engineer it to go out to 30K, then it's pretty much by definition flat to 20K. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the reasons.
Yeah.
But I do put it in this waveguide because one of the things we have to do when we've designed a two-way speaker, imagine an ideal speaker being a single source. You can't produce that practically because the requirements for producing bass is different from producing high frequencies. Mm-hmm. One has to move a large volume of air, but slowly. The other has to produce a small volume of air, but very fast.
Got it.
Those are incompatible. So you split to two-way, but now you've separated your sound in two pieces. You're aware of image height. Mm-hmm. You can tell sound source elevation. So your harmonics are coming from there. Your fundamentals are coming from there. You hear that. Secondly, in the frequency range of crossover, where both drivers are active, phase relationship between the two matters. And as you stand up and sit down, you're a different distance from the drivers. So it alters their apparent phase between them, so you get peaks and dips in response. Thirdly, as you move anywhere off axis, sound sources are directional above a certain frequency.
Right.
All sound sources at low frequencies spread all the way around. High frequencies, they start to focus, just like taking a flashlight.
They start getting narrower and narrower.
The point at which they start to narrow is defined by the size. So in a 6-inch driver, it's going to happen in the 1 to 1.5K region. For a 1-inch tweeter, it's not going to happen until 6, 7, 8K. The problem with that is we hear sound from all the way around, not just on axis. If I were to balance the response speed perfectly flat on axis, if I move off axis, I'm moving into a region in space where the output is falling off at the higher frequencies from the woofer, but not yet falling off from the tweeter. So the response has to start to dip out below crossover, come back up at crossover until it starts to fall higher up. You hear that.
Mm-hmm.
It causes room interface problems, sidewall first image reflection issues, and imaging as you move off axis.
Mm.
So the answer to that is try and match directivity.
Mm-hmm.
So from everything I understood about doing concentric drivers, when you have none of those problems,
what
can you do if you're not using concentric driver? You put it into a waveguide.
Mm-hmm.
The waveguide matches the directivity to the top end of the woofer.
Mm-hmm.
So now off axis, you just get a gentle tilt down in response. And that sounds much more natural than something like that. So that's the job of the waveguide.
Cool. Now, these speakers are about
86 to 87.
I'm going to say something to you. The speakers, you rate them at quote unquote 6 ohms. Listen, do not pay that much attention to a speaker being a 4-ohm load or an 8-ohm load because all the manufacturers lie. They all lie. They all lie. I mean, except for this guy. No, I want to say something though. If you have a tube amp, if you have a tube amp and it's got a 4-ohm tap and an 8-ohm tap, you always have to use the tap that sounds best because speakers change impedance based on frequency all the time. So these 8-ohm speakers, they might dip down to 2 ohms and manufacturers oftentimes they don't tell you. There's strange things that can happen. This speaker is about 85 dB efficient. He calls it a 6-ohm speaker, but it really does not dip below what?
4.8
ohms. So that's what you're looking for, a nice steady impedance curve. Amplifiers love that, whether they're tube, whether they're solid state. So even though this speaker does on paper like a little bit more power, it doesn't mean you're, I was just running these on a 36 watt tube amp and it was absolute heaven. So don't get too worked up about that. Don't get ever worked up about a speaker saying it's a 4-ohm speaker. What that usually means is that the manufacturer is being more honest than the guys that bullshit and say it's 8-ohm when they are not. It's a beautiful loudspeaker, and at $600 a pair is an achievement, and I love them so much. You're going to come back, mm-hmm. and we're going to talk about your other loves, other driver technologies, because Andrew is a master of designing drivers. And we're going to come back and do something on concentric drivers and some of his other models that he's coming out. But the thing is, I'm so thrilled to have Andrew Jones here. And I'm so thrilled to have a guy. Look, it's great to make things for the .com dudes that got a lot of jack. I got that. But I love it when people can buy something that's accessible and affordable that just kicks the living shit out of products that cost so much more money. Go to our website, upscaleaudio.com. Talk to my salespeople. They're not on commission. If you buy them, you don't like them, you can give them back to us. We'll give you back every penny of your money and thank you for buying it in the first place. I promise we'll treat your system like it's ours. Thanks.
Thank you.